please join me in welcoming our guest speaker this morning, Mr. Sanjeev Jayaratnam.
Good afternoon. All right, we're on. Okay, so after that very interesting session on the CFO's role on collaboration, and then even our topic for the conference, collaborate and compete, I think one of the common things that are there is probably, if you're going to compete in any case, there's going to be stress. Correct? Yes, no? And now we are supposed to collaborate as well. Is that going to add to our stress, you think? Probably. So I was talking to some friends of mine who happen to be chartered accountants and CFOs, and asking these guys, look, is stress a problem in this field? And what this friend of mine said is, it generally happens once a month. yeah, so there is like a stress cycle that that accounting professionals need to go through. I have been actually involved in lots of different functions over the years of working in various places, but the one thing I know nothing about is finance. Yeah, so you have to excuse me there. No, absolutely nothing about finance. But then y'all are all the experts, so I don't really need to. So replacing stress with fun. I told them to put the house lights on, one eye so that I can see your faces. It's always nice to see. And two, so that I can actually, hopefully we can do some interaction. Yeah, it has all been very serious topics so far. I have been listening as well. Listening to some of the topics actually increased my stress levels. let's try to have some fun as it goes. So let me ask you first of all, how many of you have ever been in this situation? Just raise your hand if you have. Ever been in this situation? Yeah, lots of us are raising our hands. I think sometimes when I ask people to raise their hands, it's a bit difficult to raise the hand also. So can we just try, forget about the question, can we just raise our hands? That's possible. Ah, super. Fantastic. So we are able to raise our hands. Super. So if you have ever been in this situation, you know it's not pleasant. You know it's not pleasant, right? Being in a stressful situation, because we even forget what we have to say. We forget what we have to do. Yeah? While seated, waiting for my chance to get on the stage, and even yesterday and day before, from time to time, I kept looking around the audience just to see, okay, now what I'm trying to do with this presentation, try to have some interaction. And I was thinking, is it going to work? Would it work? And I thought, yeah, probably, probably. But there's also something in your hands that I saw people using from time to time that actually adds to the stress. Yeah? I saw one set of, quickly put it back, and that's great, right? So we've been in this situation. So who causes our stress? Who causes our stress? Is it our boss? Is it the boss? Is it the spouse? Is it our kids? Is it our colleagues, our subordinates, our teams? Yes? No? Who causes the stress? Ah. Could the stress be caused actually by us? So again, show of hands. How many of you think, by the way, that your stress could possibly be caused by you? Ah, excellent. So then there's no problem, right? If it's caused by you, why cause it? Come on. That's amazing. If your stress is being caused by you, why would you want to cause it? Unless you like take great pleasure in having stress. Yeah, there are some people, right, who really like pain. Yeah? The more the pain, the happier people are. Well, I'm not like that. I don't want any pain. No pain. Yeah? So if we cause the stress, could we actually solve our own problem? How many of you would like to know how to do this? If I'm causing my own stress, if I know a way that I can actually control this and take it away, how many of you would be happy to know how? Happy to know how? Really want to know how? Eager, hunger to know how? Right, so hands up going up in the balcony also. Not all the hands, by the way, up in the balcony. Yeah? Generally, you know, at a conference of this nature, the most energetic people are up in the balcony. So let's try to prove that point, guys. Okay, so effects of stress. From research that is being done now in the world, people are saying, doctors are saying, that the main cause of death for our generation, for people in our age, is not cardiovascular, is not cancer, it's stress-related. It's stress-related. And that's really scary. These are not my figures. These are figures available to anyone. So these are some of the effects of stress. It hurts our immune system, brings on things like Alzheimer's earlier on in life. We start to lose memories. Yeah, we get tired, obviously. Fatigue. Yeah, heart attacks. Blood pressure goes up. Growth, health, and maintenance are compromised. Now, what is this growth, health, and maintenance? Do you know that people say once in, well, it differs. Some people say 3 months, some people say about 7 months or even a year. Let's say a year. Once a year, all the cells in our body are entirely new. Once a year, all cells in our body are entirely new. And what that means is that every day, every minute of every day, some cells in our body are being killed. And there has to be new growth to replace those cells. Now, the problem is, if we are under stress, the cells still die, but growth is impaired. Growth is impaired. And that is why we get gastritis when we are under stress. Because I'm told the stomach lining, the cells of the stomach lining, are completely replaced every 3 days or so. Every 3 days. So if you're stressed out in those every 3 days, if you're like stressed out for 3 days, those cells don't get replaced. And then the acid is there, and we get gastritis. Does that make sense? Yeah? I'm not a doctor. But I read a lot. And these are some of the things that I have learned by actually reading. So not good, right? All not good. Not good. So what do we do? Now, if you can have fun, John, if you can have fun, it means that you are? If you are having fun, it means that you are? What? Stressed, is it? No. It means that you are itch. It means that you are, come on, if you're having fun, it means that you are happy. Yes? If you're having fun, it means that you are happy. So, if we are to actually put some of the things I'm going to tell you into practice, I need you to interact. Now, is that possible? Or is this beyond the realm of chartered accountants? Is it possible? Yes? Can I hear yes? Fantastic, I heard you speak. Wonderful. No more beautiful sound. Okay, so what I would like you to do initially is just, could you look around you at the people seated on either side of you and also in front or behind? Can you just take a minute and do that? Wow, fantastic. Fantastic. Now, I noticed lots of you, when you were doing this, actually had a smile on your face. Yeah? Now, having a smile on your face is not smiling like this. It's not good. Yeah? A smile on your face means actually showing some teeth. So you go. Yeah? And that is one thing we could do. The more we smile, there is actually a chemical reaction that takes place in our brain that makes us happier. See, primates, we are part of the primate family. Yeah, we smile when we are happy. So even if you're not happy and you do smile, your brain is tricked into thinking you are happy. Yeah, it is. It is. It is. So can we pretend we are happy now and smile? We can. Super. The next thing I would like you to do is, because we are very social people, and People are also saying, the more friends we have, the more we talk to other people, like-minded people, yeah, our stress levels go down. So now you looked around and saw who the people around you were. If you know the people around you, could you just take a minute and tell the person on either side of you something they don't know about you? But if you don't know the person on either side, could you just introduce yourself very quickly? You could talk to her. Has it no one to talk to? Okay. Okay, super. Super. Okay, so one more thing that I want you to do, and I'll tell you the scientific reason behind this once we actually do it. So now that you have spoken to the person next to you, the ice has broken a little bit, you've got to know each other maybe a little bit. Yeah? Now, I think Nathan spoke yesterday about innovation. Was that right? Innovation. I think innovation and creativity go together, right? Is it? Innovation and creativity go together? Yeah. So now I need you to be really creative. I need you to be really creative. Is that possible? Yeah? Is that possible? We give it a try. Fantastic. Fantastic. Right? Really creative. Right. You looked at the people on either side of you. Now I'll tell you the scientific reason behind this after we have done it. All right? Okay. I want you, just take a minute or two and think of something nice to say to the person on either side of you. A compliment. A compliment. Don't say it. Don't say it. Just think of something to say. If you don't know the person, it could be just something like, wow, I really like your tie. It really looks nice. Yeah? Or it brings out the color of your blue eyes or something. It doesn't matter. Yeah? Right? Okay. Yeah. All right? So I said, you have to be creative. You have to be creative. Take a minute and think of something. Don't say it till I tell you when. Right? Just think of something. Aren't we having fun? You want to say something to her? We might be making friends. Okay. Sorry? He wants to say something to her. Do you want to say something as well? No. Okay. Okay. Are we thinking? Something nice, huh? So compliment is not I hate you or something. No, that doesn't qualify. Yeah? Something nice. Something nice. Okay, are we ready? Those who are ready, just raise your hand if you have got something. Come on, chartered accountants, you guys are creative. Fantastic people. All right, can you now say it? Say it to the person next to you. Your compliment. Your compliment. Come on, people, let's have some fun. Backhanded compliment, is it? Okay, super, fantastic. Give ourselves a clap, guys. Thank you so much. Wonderful, wonderful. Now I told you I'll tell you the scientific reason behind this. See, this is actually coming from a book by a guy called Dr. Wayne Dyer, which is called The Power of Intention. Fabulous book, so if you like it, go and have a read. He says that this experiment has been done in the area of social psychology. See, there is a brain chemical, a neurotransmitter, that makes us happy. This is something called serotonin. Serotonin makes us happy. It's a happy chemical. Yeah? So when the levels of serotonin go up, we become happy. When they go down, we become sad. Simple as that. Simple as that. So if someone is in clinical depression, for example, we need to take the guy to a psychiatrist. Psychiatrist prescribes some medicine, some tablets. You know what these tablets contain? Serotonin in artificial form. He takes the tablets. He's happy again. All right? Now, the interesting thing is, when you appreciate someone, you give them a compliment, the serotonin level in the person, the recipient of the compliment, goes up. As you just saw, right? Too much of serotonin. Yeah. Yeah, now that also could happen, right? You're so happy you want to go out and share it with someone else. So that's what Arjuna was doing, because he wanted to share it with his wife. So he called her up, darling, yeah, I'm really happy. So that's great, yeah? So when you pay a compliment to someone, the recipient of the compliments, serotonin level goes up. He becomes happy, or he, she becomes happy. Clear? Now, the interesting thing is, let's say, if I pay a compliment to Aruna, Aruna's serotonin level goes up. He becomes happy. Strange thing, I'm happy as well. My serotonin level goes up as well. And isn't that fantastic? I didn't get a compliment, I just paid one, but I made him happy, and I'm happy as well. So even if you do it for completely selfish reasons, just to make yourself happy, paying compliments is a good thing. It works, right? But do you know the most interesting thing of this experiment? Let's say everyone else in this room didn't do a thing. You just observe the interaction between Aruna and myself. You know what happens? So his level went up, he became happy. My level went up, I became happy. You observed this. And you know what happened? You became happy as well. Isn't that fantastic? Isn't that fantastic? Now tell me, how much did this cost? You guys are financial people talking about budgeting. How much did this cost? Zero. Absolutely nothing. Yeah? You can put this into place in your organizations from, I don't know, Monday. You know what happens? Did you notice what happened in this hall as soon as you started paying compliments to each other? Something went up. What went up? What went up? Yeah? People were smiling. The energy level went up. The energy level became almost tangible. And that's fantastic. So, and you had fun, right? You had fun? Yes? Don't fall asleep on me, yeah? Yeah? Few more things to do. So, when we pay a compliment we get to something called a happy high. Now, I'm sure lots of us are familiar with getting high, yeah? But this is a happy high. You're high because you're happy, not because of something else. Yeah, and that's great. So, if I paid the compliment, I became happy. You became happy because you got the compliment. Everyone became happy because they observed it. Super. Super. Easy thing to do. Easy thing to do. Have fun. No stress. So if you're having fun, we are happy, we are more energetic, and we also become more productive. And that might actually help us to collaborate and compete even better. Yeah? It's always good to have a happy employee, isn't it? A happy employee, you don't have to push the guy to work. He wants to work anyway. He wants to work anyway. Yeah? So we are talking of stress. So again, a show of hands. Now I noticed some of you have got back to your phones. Just try to keep it aside for a moment, because it just adds to your stress, and I hate this. I don't want to stress you out. Yeah? Too bad, right? Yeah? Okay. So how many of you would prefer if you would never have stress again in your life? Show of hands. No more stress ever. Ever. No more stress ever. Wow. Super. Thank you. But you know, there is a problem. There is a problem. Because if we eliminate the mechanism for stress in our bodies, we might actually die. We could actually die, cease to exist. Because the stress mechanism in our body is there for a reason. It's there because in some instances, we actually need it. Does that make sense? In some instances, we actually need it. So let me walk you through a little example. Could we knock off all the lights? Complete. Stage also. Just keep the screen on. I'm just going to tell you a small story, right? Yeah. Is that okay? Yeah. Don't get scared, though. Huh? Happening? Or shall we leave it like that? Ah, that's better. Yeah, that, leave it there. Otherwise, they might get scared. Don't. Yeah. Okay. Right. Now imagine, you are walking down a lonely road at night. Walking down a lonely road at night, you're on your way home after the Chartered Accountants Conference because there was this cocktail, and so it went on for very long, and you had fun. Now you're gone home. You're on your way home, and now you're dropped somewhere. You have to walk 100 meters to your home. Only one light on the road, and suddenly that light also goes off. Yeah? So whether you're a boy or girl, I'm being kind, whether you're a boy or a girl, yeah, it could be quite scary, right? And now let's say you're walking, you hear footsteps coming up behind you. And deep breathing, someone deep breathes, going and walking up behind you, right? Quite scary. And then you turn around to see who it is, and you see that. Okay, could we have the lights back on, please? Thank you. Now, house lights also. House lights also. Now, this could be quite a stressful situation, isn't it? Because this guy is not coming to come and say, how are you, or ask you how the conference went or something, right? Yeah? Okay, this guy is coming with something in mind which is probably not going to be too pleasant. I have nothing against this guy. And if you have a friend who looks like that, who's a lovely person, yeah, just forget I said this. But it could be quite dangerous, right? Now, in a situation like this, the stress response needs to kick in. If it doesn't, we might die. And that is why we have a stress response. All right? So we need to have a stress response to face situations like this. So what happens? So I'll just step over here so you can see the slide as well. Now, when we see this guy, our body needs to get into what is called a flight or fight response. I have freeze also there, but freeze is the worst thing that you could do. Flight or fight. What is flight or fight? This guy is coming up behind you. You need to either turn around and defend yourself, or you need to run as fast as you possibly can. Yes? Now, to do this, your body needs to get into the stress mechanism. So what your body does is, no sooner you see this guy, the signal goes to your eyes, goes to your brain. Brain analyzes this and says, danger. Danger. And it sends the command to the part of the brain whose only objective is survival. It's not interested what you learned. It's not interested in collaboration. It's not interested in anything, right? The only thing it is interested in is survival. I'm going to help you to survive this moment so that you can live to fight another day, live another day, or live to collaborate another day, whatever, right? Yeah? So that's the amygdala. The amygdala is this part of the brain right in the middle there somewhere, yeah, which is basically running on emotions. That's all. Amygdala doesn't know right or wrong. You tell the amygdala, I'm scared. Amygdala says, all right, I will help you to survive. And the amygdala is a part of the old brain that we have. When I say old and new, now you're probably thinking, oh, come on, I have only one brain. What do you mean old and new? Right? The amygdala is part of what is called the reptilian brain as well. It has been around for like millions and millions of years. This part, the prefrontal cortex, is the newest part of the brain to evolve, and actually only humans have it, and chimpanzees to some extent. Yeah? So it has evolved the most in us, and I'll tell you why a little later. So amygdala takes control. And when the amygdala takes control, we are talking of the CEO's role and the CFO's role and things like that, right? Now, amygdala is like the security guard of the organization. Now, imagine for a moment, the security guard is giving instructions to the CFO and the CEO. So security guard is making policy. Security guard is saying, no, this is what our spend on marketing is going to be. It's going to be just 2% of, right? Yeah. Or security guards, no. From tomorrow, it's going to be 50% of revenue on marketing. Yeah. And the CEO says, come on, but no, we can't do this. But security guard is in charge. So that's what happens here. Amygdala is taking control. Amygdala takes control and basically hijacks the function of the CEO. Why? For survival. For survival. So what happens is, amygdala immediately sends a signal to the heart and says, heart, stay with me now. You need to pump faster because I need more blood. Why blood? I need more blood for the muscles, the main muscles, the big muscles of the bodies, which is the arms and legs, so that we can run faster. So the heart keeps pumping faster and sends more blood to the muscles. Now, the interesting thing is, we only have a finite amount of blood, right? Now, if more blood is going into the arms and the legs, where is it going from? Yes? Yes, it's going to these muscles from this area. So it's moving away from the heart, from the stomach, from the kidneys, or I don't know, whatever it is, right? Moving away, because those are not necessary for survival. We have to survive now. Yes? And it also moves away from this part of the brain and sends more blood back here. So CEO loses even more control. Yeah? Security guard in charge. Yeah? Now, this is not really a great thing, right? But it helps you to survive this situation. So this guy is chasing you. Yeah? You are able to outrun him or fight and go away. Now, that's fine. Because after you have run away, gone home, now you're having a cup of tea, your stress levels will come down. And you're back to normal. Now, the problem is if we have something called chronic stress, which is stress levels go up, they don't come down. So when you get up in the morning, you're stressed. When you go to work, you're stressed. Midday, you're still stressed. End of day, you're stressed. You go home, you're stressed, which means you make your whole family stressed as well. Right? So that cycle is there, which means the stress hormones level is high, and it doesn't really come down. And that's not a good thing. Yeah? We understand? So we need stress in these situations, but not... Okay, if a dinosaur is chasing you, yeah, you need stress in that situation. Because otherwise, yeah, you get eaten up, right? So there is a story that if a dinosaur was chasing, no dinosaur is going to chase us, but imagine a big fat dog or something, right? If a dinosaur or a dog is chasing you and going to bite you, if you have time to turn back and try to recognize the breed or the whatever of the dog, it's probably too late. Yeah? You're going to get bitten. So amygdala takes control, it's immediate action, run, fight. Yeah, run, fight. So we need stress in this situation. So stress is necessary, but not in that situation. Let's say your boss is scolding you. I don't think even the worst boss is going to eat you. Yeah, right? Scold you, yes. Right? Could be really, 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 like you could be unpleasant, but you're not going to die. So we shouldn't need to get into the stress response. Am I making sense? Same way, if you are asked to speak in front of an audience of this size, my guess is most people, or lots of us, would feel stressed out. Yeah? Now, I have been speaking for many, many years, but while I was waiting for this, the time for me to get on stage, I was stressed out. Yeah? And it happens to all of us, I would guess. Yeah? But of course, again, I know rationally, look, you're not going to eat me. Yeah? Even if I'm the worst speaker on earth, the worst you'll do is probably boo or something. But yeah, I won't die. Correct? But stress levels can still go up. Now, it's not necessary, though, in these situations. Do you see that? In these situations, stress is not necessary. So why do we have it? Why? See, when a dinosaur is chasing you, we get into panic mode. As soon as we get into panic mode, which is what is happening, I am saying, my God, I might die. I need to panic here. Please help me. So it's panic. As soon as I say panic, amygdala takes control. Now the problem is, when there's an audience also, if my first reaction is panic, the mind again gets back into that stress response. Back into the stress response, which is, If it's panic, amygdala needs to take control. Do you follow? Now, who is telling us to panic? We are. It's all about our perception or belief. Now, there's an emerging field called epigenetics. Very interesting field. I just started reading up about it. Epigenetics. Now, epigenetics is telling us that even our genes can be changed by the environment. And when I say environment, perception of the environment. Now, there will be some of you, if you're given an opportunity to speak, you'll think, wow, fantastic. And you're looking forward to it with eagerness. Correct? You're looking forward to it with eagerness and anticipation and energy. So therefore, there is no panic. Do you see? It's the same audience. But if someone else thinks, and the perception of the other person is, my gosh, this is going to be a scary experience. I don't know what I'm going to say. I might forget what I have to say. And the perception is audience equals panic. Then the amygdala is going to take control again. Yeah, and you might sneeze as well or cough, yeah. Right? Amygdala is going to take control again. So it's about our perception or belief. What is your perception? What is your belief about the situations that give you stress? Now, that is an important thing that you can actually take home. Think about the situations that stress you out. And what is your perception or belief about these situations? If you can change your perception, you will actually change your stress response as well. Do we follow that? And that's well, it's not that easy, but it's not difficult either. It can be done. So our prefrontal cortex, or the CEO. Now, the CEO of the brain is even more important than the CEO of a company. Because the CEO of the brain does all these things. Initiative, goal formation, looking at alternatives, looking at different possibilities. Yeah, looking at creativity, imagination, free will. All of this is controlled by this front portion of the brain. So when the amygdala takes control, we lose all of that. And that is really the problem. So the amygdala hijacks the CEO, and blood moves away from the amygdala, from the CEO's area, the prefrontal cortex, to the amygdala. So we lose this blood as well. And we lose these functions. That is why, I'm sure, tell me whether it has happened to anyone. Just raise your hand if it has. Where you have gone for an exam, been quite nervous about the paper, gone, sat down at the table, the paper comes to you, your mind goes blank. Has it ever happened? Some hands are going up. Yeah? Hasn't it also happened that when you started relaxing after the paper was over, you remembered the answers? That's because amygdala took control, and you forgot, and then later on, the control came back to see you, and you remembered. Yeah? So why lose the CEO? Now, if we are fighting an infection, a diarrhea infection or something like that, and also being chased by a dinosaur, what's more important? Running away, right? So running away takes priority. Forget the diarrhea, forget the infection. Running away takes priority. So our immune system goes down when we are under stress, which means we become more susceptible to disease. And these other problems also happen. So when the blood moves away from the prefrontal cortex, we have to depend on reflex or subconscious behavior, which is run as fast as you can. Do what you normally do in this situation. So if I have to speak to an audience, even though I know the audience is not going to eat me, I will get into the reflex, which is audience equals scary. There's a sensation. We get it from our senses, our eyes, our ears, on what is happening in the environment. We perceive this sensation in different ways. Now, there is choice. How do we want to perceive this? I'm almost done, so just give me a few more minutes. Right? How do we want to perceive this? And that is our choice. We are in control there. Do I perceive it as excitement, as energy? Do I perceive it as fear, as scary, as panic? So, sensation, perception. Based on my perception, my body equips myself for the reaction that the body thinks is the best. So what's the best reaction? Dinosaur chasing, best reaction, run away. Yeah? Or if it's excitement, reaction is embrace it. Yeah? Have fun with it. Have fun with it. And the reaction leads to actually the action. So sensation, perception, reaction, action. And if we can control the perception, that's all. Everything else will fall into place. You won't be stressed again. But we need to control the perception. So, a meeting with the board, for example, is it scary or is it opportunity? Perception. Yeah, a meeting with a difficult customer. Are you going to get really scolded or is it opportunity to turn it around? Perception. So think of what is the perception in these situations going to be. So what do we do? What do we do? So this is the last thought to leave with you. What do we do? How do we reduce stress? What do we do? Yes, sorry?
One, that my cricket team wins by 7 wickets.
Okay.
I'm free of the stress.
Okay.
Second is, if I win $5 million in the raffle, that two things free me from the stress.
Free me from the stress. Super. So one of the things that the gentleman said, if you win $500 million in the raffle, actually there's a talk on...
Five million.
Is it $500 million better or worse?
No.
Too much. Okay, $5 million. There is a talk on TED where they have done a survey between paraplegic people and people who won the lottery. And they have found that after a period of time, after 6 months or 1 year after this event, first where one guy actually lost the function of his legs, let's say, and other where he won a lottery, after 1 year, actually the paraplegic is happier than the one who won the lottery. So we'll get to that later. But that's just an aside. So what do we do? Change perception. Change our beliefs. Now there is a technique you can use to do this, which is called visualization. There is no time to go into that now, but if you're interested, there's plenty of material around where you can read up on it. Visualize. How do I visualize this as a different thing? Compliments. That's what you did, and you had some fun, and you took away the stress. Yeah? That's a second. Also, to be grateful for what we have. If you're grateful for what you have, you cannot be stressed out with what you do not have. Yeah? So let's be realistic. There's always someone in the world who's going to be better off than we are. But we forget that there are so many thousands who are worse off than we are. A choice again. How do I want to look at it? So glass half empty or half full. Yeah? Regular breaks. Now, I don't know how this will sit with you, but regular breaks. There's something called ultradian sprint. Ultradian sprint. For work, flat out for 1.5 hours. Then get up from your seat and take a conscious break of 10 minutes. That 10 minutes becomes like a revitalization. So you're like, you're new again. Even if it's 2 o'clock in the afternoon, you feel like it's 9 o'clock in the morning. But 10-minute conscious break, where you actually close your eyes, do some deep breathing, do some meditation, it's like resetting yourself. Now you need to have the guts to do it. I do a lot of coaching for people, and lots of the people I coach have actually put this into practice now, and they are seeing results. They are seeing results. But you have to have the guts to do it. If you say, no, I don't have time to take a 10-minute break, well, too bad, then that's you lose. But if you can, you won't feel tired during the day because it's a revitalization, right? Ohio is not the place in the US, but it's only handle it once. If a document comes to your table, only handle it once. Finish it, pass it off. What do? We work on the document for 5 minutes, Then we reply an email. Then we make a telephone call. Then we go back to a document. And so we are doing the document, which could have been done in half an hour, for 4 hours. As to stress. Well, exercise. You see, lots of people have embraced this whole thing of exercise, isn't it? Yeah, people running, people walking, people doing various things. Some new research again, well, not that new, from the early 2000s, is telling us that when we do regular exercise, there are more brain cells that actually grow. When we do more exercise, there is more brain cells that grow. Neurogenesis. So when we grow older, although our brain cells die, we don't have to be scared anymore. Because if we work out, these cells are being replaced. As these cells are being replaced. Yeah, and that's always a good thing. And of course, have some fun with music. Music. Yeah, universal language. Everyone loves it. Loved most by people who can't sing to save their soul, right? But that's also actually a myth. Everyone could sing. Yeah, so music. So this is all I actually have for you. I hope you had some fun. I know it's a bit late, it's 1:20. I was actually very aware that I was the only person holding you up from your lunch. And that could be quite stressful as well. So thank you very much for having stayed the distance and actually been fully involved. Yeah, so music. We were thinking of doing some little thing with you, but I'm not sure if you would want to. So I don't, maybe a show of hands. You have the opportunity to do something. I think it's, I'm almost sure it's a first for the chartered accountants in Sri Lanka, possibly a first for chartered accountants globally, where we use this whole audience and create a human beatbox. It'll probably take another 5 minutes. If you like, only. If you want to do it, raise your hand. If you're game. All right, but you need to work with me. You need to work with me. All right, super, fantastic. Right, so let's do this. Do you see this thing there where it says Yamaha? I'm not sponsoring Yamaha, right? This is just a picture I picked up. Yeah, Yamaha. Now, that's the bass drum. If we want to make the sound of the bass drum, let's have this row, and this row, and you guys be the bass drum, right? So the bass drum noise is a D and a B together. Imagine that now. A D, letter D and a letter B together. So it goes dub, 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 dub. Can we do that? With my hand only, right? With my hand. So we go dub, 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 dub. You need to make the sound, guys. Like, you can't imagine the sound in your head. You need to open your lips and, yeah? Visualizing is not going to help here. So letter D and the letter B together. Shall we try? So if I say it, it's dub, dub. Shall we try? And? Can we make it louder? Come on, guys. Right, super. So you guys are the bass drum, right? You guys are the snare drum. These two columns. I'm coming to you, right? The snare drum. The snare drum. So imagine you're taking the stick and you're hitting the rim of the drum. The rim of the drum. Yeah? So at one point we were going to have a drum set here, but it didn't work out. Anyway, the rim of the drum. Now that makes the sound like K-I-H. K-I-H. So it goes K, 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 K. Can we write it? K-I-N-H together. Try it. Very good. Now, don't worry about spitting at each other. That's fine. Yeah? Right? One of the problems with beatboxing is that there's a lot of spit that comes out. Sorry to be repulsive before lunch, but it's the truth. So if we put these two together, so we go, dip, dip. Okay, shall we try that? 1, 2, 3, 4. Super. Now you guys are going to be that cymbal that is played with the foot. Have you noticed that? It's called the hi-hat. Cymbal played with a foot. Now that sound is a T and a S together. T-S. So it goes. Very good. You guys, have you been practicing this? TNS. Okay, shall we try? So you, when they go, you go. All right, ready? 1, 2, 3, and. Wow, let's try to put it all together. These are human beatbox guys. So we are making history here. Is this the first time? Yeah? Okay. Making history, right? Making history. So we'll go. Okay, shall we try? 1, 2, 3, 4. 2. Ah, okay. Little bit more complicated, right? So you guys have 1 and then 2. So you get dip, 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 dip. Is that okay or too complicated for you? So it's 1 and then 2. So it's 1, 1, 1, 2. 1, 1, 2. It's dip, 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 dip. You have to try. And you just go on the offbeat. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, let's give ourselves a big round of applause. Fantastic. Thank you for being great sports and for getting into the spirit of things. I was actually worried, but I had no reason to be. You guys are absolutely fantastic. So have a fantastic future. Remember, get rid of stress. You can do anything. Yeah? You can do anything. Just remember that it's all our perception. It's in our hands. It's our beliefs. It's our control. Thank you very much. Thank you.